Samuel, welcome to another episode of Kopa TV. And dalam episode kali ini, we speak to the Academy Director of Mokhtar Dahari Academy di Malaysia, which is Dennis Brecking. And of course, he tells us all about his experience and also who he thinks we need to look out for in Malaysian football. So stay tuned. Okay. Hello, Dennis. Welcome to another episode of Kopa TV and Footballita. Well, in this show, we actually interview personalities in football in Malaysia and across Asia. So I understand that you are the Academy Director for the Mokhtar Dahari Academy, right? And previously, you were also the Academy Director of FC 20 in the Netherlands. Am I right?
Yes, good afternoon, and correct, you were informed, all are true. And I must say, after I was a sporting director also for a while. So yeah, I did my things.
So how has your experience been? I mean, you recently came to Malaysia. Maybe you can tell me a little bit more about that.
Yeah, sure. I think my first time I came here in the country, been in Asia a couple of times. The first time I was here was in December.
Yep.
Get a proper feel for the country, for the people, also for AMD, NFDP. And I must say, I was positively surprised because, to be honest, I didn't really have any expectations or any vision besides the things that people told me, obviously. But I was immediately impressed by the facilities, by the openness of the people, the way I was welcomed. I didn't see that many players at that point, but the ones I saw already were very talented. So yeah, it was another positive surprise after another. So yeah.
So coming from FC 20, obviously a club with a lot of
enthusiasm.
Okay, sorry, I interrupted you there because I didn't know if you had finished.
No.
Sorry, it's a bit of a lag. But coming from a club which is obviously in another level, you know, FC 20, and then you're coming to Asia. What are the differences that you see from your short time here? I mean, you're bringing in a European culture to players, for example. And how do you cope with that?
Yeah, well, I must say, on that part, the difference, especially looking again at facilities, I think the facility built in Gambang is absolutely of European standard. So on that part, I don't think it's any less than I'm used to in Europe. On the other hand, as I said, the players are good level. So I don't know. Maybe I speak out of turn. But maybe it's an Asian thing to maybe think a little less of yourself, even though you have a lot of things to be proud of.
You said that you visited some stadiums in Malaysia. So I'm pretty sure you have been to the Johor Stadium as well. So when talking about world-class stadium, is that the one that you're particularly talking about, or are you talking across Malaysia?
I haven't visited many stadiums yet because I've mostly been in AMD, because it's been crazy busy in a good way.
Yep.
To do my job as AMD director and try to,
yep,
support the players and the staff in the best way possible. So I've seen a national stadium. I believe it was the cup final I saw,
yep,
in December.
Yep.
Yeah, which is basically my only reference to the stadiums,
yeah,
here. So I mostly spoke about the AMD facility, training facility, which is actually a very high standard.
I have to agree, actually. Bukit Jalil Stadium, Dennis, is one of my favorite stadiums. When I remember in 2012, Arsenal went to play there, and they actually said that it didn't feel different from like a European stadium. I think it's the way that they look after the pitch and also the way it's designed, right? I would say. Would you agree with that?
yeah, for sure. Here, how do you call it? You have cow grass and Bermuda grass.
Mm.
We only have Bermuda grass, so that's a little different.
Back to the question. I mean, obviously now we are facing an unprecedented situation with the COVID-19 pandemic. And football has, I would say, been interrupted as well. So what have you been up to? And what are you keeping busy with?
Yeah. Well, first of all, my family just came in about two and a half weeks before the whole COVID-19 situation started.
Okay.
So they're still very new here. Unfortunately, they haven't seen much more yet than the inside of our condo walls. So then again, also my kids have started in their new school. And
that's great.
Yeah, it's fantastic. They love it. And it's completely different than what they are used to. So I think you have a very, very academic culture here in Asia, where maybe Europe it's not less academic, but maybe the approach is a little bit different. So I've been trying to support them and helping them in adjusting to the school system over here. But most of all, we have been trying to continue our work with the coaches, with the players. So we've been webinars with the coaches, with coaches from the UK, from the Netherlands. Coaches have to do learning and development assignments. The players have to do their physical exercises and do their game analysis. So I think basically the same as everybody. We are trying to keep things going online and try to be creative in it.
Can you explain to us a little bit more about your role at the Mukta Dahari Academy? So what's your day-to-day like? So obviously there's a lot that you have to do, right? As a director.
Yeah. True. I don't know if everybody knows, but basically we are hosting between 250 and 300 players, plus over 40 full-time staff. So managing that is a fun thing to do, but sometimes also quite challenging. To what I do, to cut that short, I think it's I can describe it very in a simple way. Like my job is to make the coaches and the players do a better job. So I need to support them. I need to help them and give them everything I have available to make them perform in a better way. So you're looking at installing a high performance culture, looking at an optimal learning environment, trying to create an environment where everybody feels safe, but at the same time is challenged in order to deliver even more and more players to the national teams and hopefully pro football after they leave AMD.
Okay, so speaking about that, obviously you're dealing with some challenges at this point of time. So what can we expect after all this pandemic is over? Do you think football in itself is going to change, you know, as an industry? Can we expect that we are going to see some changes after this? Because a lot of fans might not get to go to a stadium for a while, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I understand what you mean. Obviously, it's highly difficult to say anything about that because nobody knows what will happen. What I do think is, I think sometimes people misinterpret that the football culture. What happens in football is basically just a reflection of what happens in real life. So what we are struggling now with is the financial difficulties, how to keep businesses running. I think it's the same for football. The whole I don't know if people are aware of the whole furlough law in the UK and in America.
Yep.
So talking about that, where big clubs put their staff on furlough, even though players make millions, then you get an economic angle and you get a welfare angle and you get emotional responses. So things are going from left to right, from front to back. Very difficult, I think, for anybody at this point to create a policy and stick to that policy, because it's chaos at some point. So
yes.
After football, sure, I have my beliefs and things, what I think will happen, but to make any statement on that is extremely difficult.
Psychologically, because when you were talking, it's across the board, not just furlough, it's not just football, but across the world. But since you work in football and you are a director and you look after players as well itself for some aspects, so how are you keeping your players positive and at this point of time? Because obviously mentally, I'm sure many of them are wondering what's going to happen. You know, am I going to have a club or stuff like that? Am I going to get paid? They have families to feed. So maybe you can talk me through that and also some advice as well that you have.
Yeah, sure. First of all, we are, especially in these times, not only looking after the players, but also trying to look after the families in every way possible within our framework, within our possibilities. We have people for that also, so we are monitoring the families, not only the football side of things, but how do players feel at home, how are the families, do they need support in any way to make everybody get through these difficult times. On the psychological side of things, I think without diminishing this whole situation, I think dealing with challenges, seeing challenges as opportunities. So on the pitch, the players need to prepare for the next challenge, and they will face a new opponent, and they will win, they will lose, they will be kicked down, they will stand up. So that's basically similar to life. So yeah, even though it might be an easy thing to say at this point, because everybody has his own struggles, some families are hit very severe. So it's too easy to say, hey, stand up, try to see it as a challenge and overcome it. But looking at the whole, I think dealing with challenges, be resilient to whatever comes your way and somehow use it to be even stronger after, is what I would say to the players. And I think not only to the players, for everybody, including myself.
So the word, the keyword, Dennis, that we should all be looking at is resilience across the board, right? You should mention it.
So
since you are from AMD, I think everybody in COPA, and I also want to know, because we had a conversation with, I'm sure you know Lukman Hakim, one of the young players of Malaysia.
Yes,
so which young Malaysian and Asian player do you think we should be looking out for? Because we have our debates, yeah, but I want to know in your perspective, who should we be looking out for in the last couple of months since you've been in Malaysia?
Yeah, I can see that question coming. First of all, I've not been here so long because my actual time in AMD has only been a couple of months. First of all, you have to analyze the whole situation. My work is mostly also done with the coaches, trying to assist the coaches. So it's been a very short time to give any opinion on any player at this point. Second of all, my job's absolutely to be neutral. So to favor one player over the other by saying anything,
You're being very neutral.
Not be at this point. So difficult question for me to answer at this point.
But obviously you come from a country which has produced fantastic youth talent. I'm not talking about FC 20, also Ajax Amsterdam. You guys have they have a world-class academy, right? In terms of generating youth talent. So is this, is this the same policy and the same structure that you want to bring to Malaysia as well? Because Malaysia and Asia in general, we have a great, I think we have a lot of youth players, but somehow along the line, they fall, you know, they lose like confidence because maybe clubs might not be, you know, fair to them. So is this something you want to bring to Asia as well? Like to inspire, I guess, the future generation?
Yeah, I understand what you mean, understand what you mean. My job is obviously within AMD, so whatever happens after and happens before is difficult for me to say something about. Again, linked to the short time I've been here.
Okay.
Besides that, I don't think it's my role also. Within AMD, yes, of course, I come from a Dutch background. I take pride into the fact that we, with Cruyff and Michels in 74, played the total football, basically the high press philosophy. Yep. I still nowadays play it with Klopp, with Nagelsmann, Red Bull Leipzig, with Guardiola. All the great coaches acknowledge themselves that somehow it was originated by people like Cruyff, as many others. So yes, of course, I try to take my, you can call it the European experience over here. But then again, it's also very important to maintain the qualities and the strength of the Malaysian culture. So it's not about me bringing my experience and making AMD into a little Ajax or whatever club for that matter. It's about analyzing it properly, looking at the strengths over here, because you have many strengths, and hopefully take a little bit of my experience, or European experience, fill in the gaps. So in the end, we can close the gap between Malaysian youth football and high-level European or European or Asian football for that matter.
Dennis, I have one last question to ask, which I think I forgot to ask, which is, what is your favourite team? Because you were talking about total football, and you mentioned Jurgen Klopp, of course, and I was like, okay. So everybody wants to know, what is your pick to win the Champions League and also the Premier League?
Oof. That's a tough one. Well, first of all, again, I basically already said something about it just now. Of course, I come from a background of total football, and it was all about adapting to changing conditions. So in that context, I like many coaches. I like the dominant on the opponent's half kind of thing. So I like teams that try to play out from the back, try to be dominant. So looking at Man City, Barcelona, I think the obvious teams to mention. But then again, I can also enjoy it because, for example, Atletico Madrid or Red Bull Leipzig are also adapting to changing conditions. Only the focus is more, is maybe more, especially with the Atletico on their defensive organization. But basically, it's the same philosophy. So those are the teams I favor, enjoy watching. I think you can learn from every game you watch, but those would be my picks for now. Also a little bit because of my background. I hope you don't mind.
My last question is obviously from the AMD Academy. So loads of kids or loads of young players might be watching this, wanting to hear from you. So what is your advice to a young kid who might want to make it someday in football? Do you have any special words words of advice for them?
Yes, of course. I think some years ago, the focus was on having a lot of talent in order to become successful in anything you do or were talented in. I think it shifted a little bit from, of course, you need the talent, but it's not as much as the confirmation that you will be a big player or a big musician or a big whatever you are talented in. But it's more of a basic requirement. Spoke to a couple of friends of mine a while ago. They were all successful businessmen, and they told me, and I asked them, why are you more successful than the thousands or millions of other businessmen or women? And they said, listen, we were not more talented, we were not better in any way, we didn't have higher skills. The only thing we did is that we continued when all the other ones stopped, when there was setback again, when there were challenges, some people dropped, and we just kept going until. So that would be my advice. Of course, you need some amount of talent, but you need resilience. Keep going, put in the effort, never give up, and try to be the best you can be.
And that's a final word from Dennis, which is resilience, guys. Thank you very much for joining us in this interview today, Dennis. All the best with the AMD, and we look forward to seeing more young talents flourish under you and your coaches, yeah?
Thank you, Dennis. Much. Enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.